Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. If you have questions about last time, do not hesitate to ask me. Professor Arup Bose mentioned me a book, Pattern on the Matrices, where there is a lot of these moments methods in random matrix theory, so you should definitely have a look at it. And what I presented last time was contained in this book, essentially. Today I will we will go to the high moment method, very high moment method. So we'll try to compute upper bounds, the expectation of the trace, where by taking a power k which goes with n, the size of the matrix. So the first one to who did that were Feridin Komlosh in 81. So I start with the statement. So we come back with our sparse Wigner matrices. Okay, so we have seen that under those assumptions, the empirical spectral distribution converges to the semicircular law. And in particular, since the semicircular law has support -2, 2, using an argument that we had seen last time, it implies that the largest eigenvalue is at least 2. Up to a little O of 1 corrections. The Feridin Komlosh theorem asserts that this bound is achieved, meaning that the limit, the almost sure limit of the largest eigenvalue or the operator norm of the matrix goes to 2 as n goes to infinity, provided that your matrices is not too sparse, where I recall you, sparsity were encoded in the bound, in the uniform bound that we add on the entries. I call it 1 over Q. And so if Q goes to infinity sufficiently fast, here a Q much larger than log n to the 4, then the operator norm of the Wigner matrices goes to 2, almost surely. And in particular, the largest eigenvalue also. Okay. From what we discussed last time, it is sufficient to prove the following statement. But if Q is larger than something like K to the fourth, we have this bound on the expected trace of the random matrices. So the expectation of the trace of H to the K is like N times 2 to the K times 2. Okay, so last time we saw that you could turn this bound into a bound on the control, on the upper bound on the operator norm on the largest eigenvalue, provided that k is much larger than log n. And the condition that we have put, that q is much larger than log n to the fourth, allows you to take such k. Okay, so this the first theorem, the convergence of the largest eigenvalue. The almost sure convergence of the largest eigenvalue is implied by this statement on expected trace. Okay, so I will try to sketch you the proof. Let's see, it's a very nice argument, my opinion, which relies on a very soft combinatorial argument. So I recall you that the expectation of the trace, we had a bound last time of this form where we were expanding the trace and putting together some elements, the paths in unlabeled paths. So we had an expression of this form, of the form n times the sum of all unlabeled closed paths of length k, which are paths of length k on the which are closed, there's an initial point the same as the starting point, and they are unlabeled, meaning that they are paths, but when you take quotients with respect to the symmetric group. And these paths have to be taken so that each edge is visited at least twice. These constraints were coming from the fact that the entries were centered. Okay, so we were summing over all these unlabeled closed paths. We are counting two terms. One is an exponent in n, the size of the matrix, where you have v gamma minus e gamma minus 1, which is the Euler characteristic or genus of the graph associated to the walk, to the path. So V gamma is the number of vertices that the walk visits. E gamma is the number of edges which it visits. And another term, which tend to put larger weights to paths which visit the largest possible number of edges. So here k over 2. Okay. So we will use a weaker form of this expression and say, so since the genus is non-negative and q square is less than 1 over n, this comes from the fact that the variance is 1 over n, and 1 over q was a bound on the entries. So the q squared is at most n. So if you do a trivial manipulation and you use just that q squared over n is less than 1 and g gamma is the genus is larger than 1, it's non-negative, sorry, you can rewrite the expectation of the trace as something where only the parameter q comes in, which is n times the sum of our L-label closed path, and you have a q power minus k plus 2 minus 2 v gamma. Okay, what I have done is just I have, in some sense, I just said that the number of edges is at least the number of vertices minus 1. Okay. Okay, so we will work with this expression. Okay. So we will count unlabeled closed paths which visit each edge at least twice in terms of the number of visited vertices. Okay, so we set WKV to be the set of paths which visit exactly V vertices. Okay. The maximum number of vertices that you visit is k over 2 plus 1 due to these constraints on the genus and on the number of maximal number of expected of visited edges. And you obtain an upper bound, which is written below, where you have to estimate a weighted sum of this number of the cardinal of WK of V, where WK of V is a set of paths with V vertices. Okay. So the smaller V is, the weight Q is becomes very small, and the larger V is, the weight Q becomes closer to 1. Okay. So we need an upper bound on the cardinal of WK of V. Okay, so this is exactly the same expression which I have rewritten down. And we have the following. So this is the core of the proof. Furedi and Komlosh told us that the number of this set is like 2 to the k times k power 8 times k over 2 plus 1 minus v. Okay? So if you assume that this bound holds, then you can replace this bound in the above expression, and you will obtain an expression for the upper bound for the expectation of the trace as n times 2 power k times a geometric series which, if q is large enough, converges. Okay, so the ratio of the geometric series is q8 over q squared, which will be less than 1. If my condition that q is much larger than square root 2k4 is satisfied. Okay, so to summarize, up to trivial manipulation, everything that we have to check is an upper bound on the number of closed paths which visits unlabeled closed paths of length k, which visits v vertices. Okay, and that's exactly what the bound of Feridian Komlosh does. So a command, the two power k is simply consistent with the fact that the right edge of the support of the semicircular law is 2. And so we expect a bound on the trace which grows like 2 power k. Okay. And so what should worry us is this exponent with k power 8 or times k over 2 plus 1 minus v. Okay. So what is the strategy? It's a nice argument. So the idea, there is no direct way, or up to now nobody has found an explicit formula for this, for the cardinal of this, for the number of elements in this set WK of V. So what we do a more rustic argument. We try to encode this set. What we mean by that? We mean that we will build an injective map from WK of V to a larger set, okay? And this larger set, hopefully, we are able to estimate its cardinality, okay? So to do that, it will be convenient to work with this canonical paths, which I have introduced last time. So the canonical paths are just canonical elements in each of it's a way to label, it's a canonical way to label the vertices of an unlabeled path. So what you do is the first visit vertex is, you call it, you label it 1, and the other one you label them 2, 3, and so on, in the order of the visits Okay. So we will try to upper bound the number of canonical paths which have V vertices. Okay. So you remember this Dick pass encoding that we had last time. So Dick pass are walks which are non-negative of length which are non-negative and start at 0 and end at 0. Okay. So the Dick pass are walks which go by plus 1 and minus 1. Okay, at each step, at time t, the number of minus 1 that you have seen is less than the number of plus 1 that you have seen so far, because it has to stay non-negative. Okay, so we will try to put a kind of deep pass encoding on this set to encode a canonical pass. Okay, so that's where the proof actually starts. So you take a canonical element, so of length k, gamma 0 up to gamma k, okay? You see that as a vector, gamma t, and you think of t as a time, okay? And now you will mark each time, we will give it a sign, okay? We will give it a sign plus if gamma t is new, okay? So in particular, the edge gamma t minus 1 gamma t, it's the first time that you see it, okay? You will mark it minus, okay? If gamma t is not new, but this is the second time, exactly the second time that you see the edge gamma t minus 1 gamma t. And you mark it star otherwise. Okay, if you remember, when we were counting the bijection that we built from Dick pass to unlabeled pass of length k, which visit exactly each edge twice, we had only in some sense plus and minus 1. Okay, so here we add a star, which is if none of the first two events occurs, we put a star. Okay, so let's see an example. Here you have a path of length 14, okay, which visits first 1, 1, and then 2, 3, and so 4, 3, and so on. So you start at 1, you come back to 1, so it's a star, because star, you already have seen 1, okay? Then you come back at 1, it's a star because you already have seen one. Okay. So then you go, I realize, okay, there is a small ambiguity in my slide, so in my definition, but it's fine. So you will put a minus only if it corresponds to an edge which was marked plus before. Okay, so you visit, I come back again. So you start with a one, you come back to one, the edge 1, 1, 1 is not a new vertex, so you put a star. You come back to 1, 1, 1, you see it for the second time, but it was not an edge, 1, 1 was not an edge marked by a plus, so you put again a star. Okay, so then you go to from 1 to 2, and 1 and 2 is a new vertex, so you put a plus. You go from 2 to 3, you put a plus. You could from, you go from 3 to 4, you put a plus, and then you come back to 3. 3, 4 was marked by a, was an edge marked by a plus, and you visit it for the second time, you, so you put a minus, and so on. Okay? If this is clear? Okay. So far we have just put decoration on the pass, on the canonical pass. So we will use these marks to build our injective map. Okay, but first some comments. So every edge, every vertex except the first one will appear at some point. So the number of pluses is V minus one. Okay. To be a minus, every plus edge will come at some time, will become a minus edge because you will have to visit it back because you see each edge at least twice. So the number of minuses is V minus one again. Okay. So, and the star edges are all the rest. So it's K, which is the total number of the length of the path, minus twice V minus one. Okay. So I call this number S, K minus two V plus two. Okay. So if my example is correct, it should work. V is five. So there should be four pluses, four minuses, and six stars. Okay, so it works. Okay. So now we build the encoding. If you know that the time t is a plus, okay, then you know what is the index. Imagine that you have encoded, imagine that you know the path gamma t up to time t, okay, up to time t minus one, sorry. And I tell you that the time t is a plus. Okay, then you know what is the exact value of gamma t. Because since it's a plus, it has to be a new vertex. And since your path is canonical, the index that you will put on this new vertex is just the largest index plus one that you have seen so far. Okay, so if the time is a plus, you know exactly where you pass go at the next step. If the time is a star, then a priori you don't know where you go. So we mark it by just putting the value of the arrival vertex, gamma t. Okay? So in particular, you know what gamma, if you know the mark, you know what gamma t is. Okay. Now, here comes an important point. If the time is a minus, then in some cases, you know where to go. In some cases, you don't know where to go. Okay, so let's look at the left hand, the picture on the left hand side. So if you do plus, plus, and then, so plus, plus, you visit two new vertices. Okay, so for example, you are here. And then if you do minus, you know, there is a unique way to backtrack from where you came from. Okay, so there is no ambiguity. Then if you put a plus again, you know where to go, and you put a minus. Okay, so you can decode when you look at this, the sequence on the left hand side. There is never, when you put a every time that you put a minus, you know where the next, you know where to go. Okay. So you know what will be the value of gamma t just by knowing that this is the second time that you have to visit an edge which is visited for the second time. Okay, but there are some cases where you have an ambiguity. So let's look at the right hand side. The picture on the right-hand side, imagine that you see three pluses, so you visit three new vertices. Then you come back to, by a star, you come back to a vertex that you have already seen. Okay? And then imagine that a minus appears. But since a minus appears, you know that you have to visit an edge which have already visited once, but there is an ambiguity. You could go either left or right. Okay? So there are some minus times which are times where which are ambiguous. Okay, you can call them the crossroad times. Okay, so you arrive at a vertex. You have arrived at a vertex where you have edges which have been visited once, and which you have at least two edges which have been visited once, and you have a minus. So then you have an ambiguity. So to lift the ambiguity, if you have an ambiguous time, which we can call a crossroad time, you mark the crossroad time by the arrival vertex gamma t. Okay, so in particular, then you completely remove the ambiguity. Okay, so then there is a small lemma, which I will not prove, but you can imagine. It's not very difficult to check, that the number of crossroad times is at most the number of star times, which were, as we have seen, exactly k minus 2v plus 2. You can see it on the picture on the right-hand side. On the left-hand side, there were no star times, and so you can see that there is no ambiguity. On the right-hand side, there were a star, and we had an ambiguity at the next minus. Okay, so by generalizing this argument and making a small picture, you will arrive to this fact that the number of crossroad times is at most the number of star times. So now the proof is over. So the position, if I give you the position of the plus times, the position of the minus times and the star times, and the crossroad times, okay, and I add the marks of and I add the marks of the extra marks of the star times and the crossroad times, which are just the position of the index of the arrival vertex. Then you can reconstruct uniquely the canonical path. Okay, so this is our encoding. So now we just have to upper bound the number of possible encodings by a very rough bound. So the position of the plus and minus is that you have a path of length k is at most 2 power k. Okay, because you at each time you put a plus or a minus. You have to decide where are the star times. So the path has length k, there are s star times, so at most k power s. The position of the crossroad times, the same. There are at most k of them, so you can put k power s. Similarly, the marks of the star times, the star times are marked by the value of the arrival vertex. So there are v vertices by assumption. So it at most v power s possibilities, and similarly for the crossroad times. Okay, so you get a very rough bound, which is exactly the Ferdig Komlosch bound. Okay, so you see, it was it's very rustic. You can imagine many ways to improve it, but this is a simpler way of doing it. Okay. So the same argument works for inhomogeneous Wigner matrices with bounded variance. Okay, meaning that if you have a matrix with centered entries and independent above the diagonal, if you assume that the expectation of the square of the L2 norm of each row is at most one, and you have the bound, all entries are bounded by 1/Q, the same argument will give you that the largest eigenvalue or the operator norm is at most 2 if Q is much larger than log n to the 4. Okay. Okay, some comments. So, as you might guess, the condition Q larger than log n to the 4 is not optimal. Okay. If you think slightly about my argument, you could at least remove, you can easily get Q larger than log n to the third, power 3, sorry. But in fact, the condition, it would be quite, you can imagine refinements, but we will see a more powerful way to solve the question. Okay. So what should be the correct answer? We have to do that. We can look at the simplest case in the family that we consider, so which are the Herder-Schwinning graph with average degree D. So I recall you, A is a matrix where you put zero and one, entry zero and one independently, and the probability to put a one is D over N. Okay. And so you have a renormalized Wigner matrix by centering the matrix and dividing by square root D or something very close to square root D. So with, if H is this renormalized Wigner rescaled adjacency matrix of an Herder-Schwinning graph, we'll obtain that Q, the corresponding Q will be square root D. And it's known that the largest eigenvalue, the operator norm of H, is close to the second eigenvalue of A divided by square root D will be 2 as soon as the degree is much larger than log n. Okay? So instead of log n to the fourth, it's log n to the fourth, it's in terms of Q, it's a Q much larger than square root log n. Okay? And this is optimal in the sense that if D is if D is of order log n, this will be a constant. The norm of H will be larger than, strictly larger than 2. And when D is much larger than log n, then the operator norm of H is much larger than 2. It goes to infinity as n goes to infinity. In fact, it's not very. It was proved that in this case, the operator norm of H, or which is close to the second eigenvalue of A divided by square root D, is close to the square root of the max degree. Okay, the fact that the square root of the max degree is a lower bound on the norm of A, on the second and largest eigenvalue of A, is not a difficult remark. You just have to observe that if you take a star graph, which means a graph with a single node and with a node at the center and let's say D or delta adjacent vertices all connected to the central node, then the norm of this matrix is of the second largest eigenvalue of this matrix is of order square root of the degree of delta. So by interlacing inequalities, it's not hard to check that the lambda 2 of the second the second largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix is at least of order of the largest of the square root of the maximal degree. Okay. So my point is just that with this Fourier Komlosh bounds, even with their refinements, nobody has been able to go down up to Q much larger than square root of log n. Okay, we will have to circumvent this combinatorial difficulty by using other tricks. Okay. In another direction, if the matrices have a symmetric distribution and Q is as large as possible, so Q, which is square root n. So for example, your matrices are just plus minus one Bernoulli variables, centered Bernoulli variables. Then you can push the trace method very far, and this has been done by Sasha Sosnikov and in 99, and he was able to capture the traceability fluctuations of linear matrices, meaning that he could prove that the largest eigenvalue has fluctuation of order n power minus 2/3, and the limiting random variable Z was universal, meaning that it was only depending on the first two moments of the variable, the second moment of the entries of the matrices, which was here one. Okay. But this type of technology is now completely out of fashion because there are, thanks to resolvent methods, the fluctuations are known in much greater generality. If my bibliography is correct, it's in terms of the sparsity, it's the fluctuation, the order of the fluctuation is known at least as soon as Q, the sparsity parameter, is larger than n power alpha, with alpha larger than 1 over 9. Okay, but these are completely different methods, which I will not comment on. Okay, a last remark is that you can also use this Talagrand concentration inequality to have an a priori deviation inequality on the largest eigenvalue or the operator norm. Okay. So I've put the largest eigenvalue, but it's also true for the operator norm. And with our assumption of independence and entries bounded by 1 over Q, you will obtain as an exponential deviation inequality with a tail, which is like minus CQ squared T squared. Okay, so if Q goes to infinity, it means that the expectation, the largest eigenvalue is very concentrated on its mean. Okay. This concentration inequality is not subtle enough to get the proper order of fluctuation in the sparse case, which are Tracy-Williams scaling n power minus 2/3, but still it holds in the whole range of Q. For proofs of this inequality, you can look at these monographs. I mentioned it yesterday, this book by Boucheron et Cosimassa. It's very nice if you want to know concentration inequalities. It's a very friendly introduction to, more than an introduction, it's a very friendly treatment of the topic. Okay. Some references. So the optimal bound, the Feridian Colmosh paper is this paper of 81. The proof which I've given you of the Feridian Colmosh bound was inspired by this paper by Van Vu. The optimal bounds on for the Hadronic graphs, I will come back to that later, but I will give you a precise reference later on. Okay, so now in the time which remains, I want to. So these are very old problems and statements, which I've said so far. Now I want to tell you about more recent techniques. And there is one very, very nice argument, which was proved by Bandera and Van Ander, which will allow us to. For example, to obtain the optimal bound for convergence of the operator norm of this rescaled Hadronic graphs. And the argument is very nice because it's a very soft argument, and it will use the Feridian Colmosh bound to obtain a new bound, a sharper bound, which is quite puzzling. So what are the assumptions? So you take matrices with independent entries above the diagonal. So I assume that the variance is at most 1 over n for all entries, and that the entries are bounded by 1 over q, as usual. Okay, so we will try to compare the trace of this matrix H, which we have been working on since the first course, with the trace of another matrix, which has a different size. So that's why H is of size n, so n is always an Eigen parameter. So here I've put explicitly the dependencies in R. S is a matrix of size R by R. It's a symmetric matrices. It's a Wigner matrix, okay? And the entries are independent. They are centered. They have unit variance. And they are recentered Bernoulli with parameter 1 over 4. You can take 1 over 6 or 1 over 10. It's okay, but less than 1 over 4, okay? You will see how this 1 over 4 comes into play. And the Bandera van Andel argument tells you that you can upper bound. You take K even, you take R, which is Q squared plus K. Okay, so Q is a viscosity parameter, and K is a power, you can, is a moment of the matrix that you consider. So the Bandera van Andel argument tells you that the expected trace of H to the K, you can bound it in terms of the expected trace of S to the K when you take R, which is exactly Q squared plus K. Okay, so okay, I will give you the proof and then I will tell you how to use that. So it's a very surprising fact that you can bound, you can compare two matrices of different size, expected trace of two matrices of different size and with different distribution of entries. How does it go? Okay, so we start with a lower bound. So you see the bound. We have to low. We know already upper bounds on expected trace of H to the K. So we'll have to find a lower bound on the expected trace of S, of powers of S. Okay, so the moment the expanding the trace as we have done always so far, you get that the expectation of trace of S power K is a sum over all closed paths. Of the it's a sum, and this sum is weighted by the expected contribution of its path, which is the expectation of the products of the weights encountered on that path. Okay? Now we can reduce that with an unlabeled closed path. So we use the fact that the entries are RID. Okay, so the Q gamma, if gamma and gamma prime are equivalent, meaning that they differ up to a permutation of the vertices, then the Q gamma, their Q gammas are equal, okay? So we can reorder this trace as in terms of sum over WK, which are the unlabeled closed paths, okay? Which is of length K, which visit each edge at least twice. And then we have seen last time as the number of elements in each canon, in each equivalence class, or the number of labeled graphs, labeled paths corresponding to an unlabeled closed path, is exactly the first V gamma terms of the expansion of the factorials. So since the matrix has size R, it's R times R minus 1 up to R minus V gamma plus 1. Okay, so you get this exact form for the expectation of the trace of S to the K. Okay, so far I've not done much, right? Only you put again ingredient that we have seen. Okay, that's where the Bernoulli the assumption comes into play. You can check. So the first moment of this recentered Bernoulli is zero. The second moment is one, and you can bound. You can look at all the other moments. Okay. And if you take P small enough, so one fourth is enough, you will find that all moments are at least one. Okay, so you have a lower bound on all moments of this rescaled Bernoullis. So I will not prove that, but it's a trivial computation, since the moments of the Bernoulli is not a particular complicated object. Okay. So you see the fact that P is less than one half. Your variable S has some is really non-symmetric. So it's plausible that since it takes larger eigen when it's positive, it's very positive. because it takes value one, bandwidth takes value one, and when it's zero, when it's negative, it's not so negative, it takes value zero, it minus p divided by square root of p minus one, so it's, this statement is plausible. Okay, so but you can prove it, obviously. So it follows that the q gamma, which is the expected contribution of each path, so which is the product of the edge of the associated graph of the times the multiplicity, is at least one. So you get the following lower bound on the expectation of the trace of s to the k. Okay. So now we use that the fact that we will correlate the size of the matrix R with the parameter k and the sparsity parameter q. Okay. So you take R, which is q squared plus k. Okay, so you use, since V gamma is bounded by K, you will have, for this choice, you will have that R minus V gamma plus 1 is at least K squared. And so you obtain this lower bound on the expectation of the trace. But now we are in very good shape because we have already seen an upper bound of the trace of a vector matrix with sparsity parameter q in terms of q power of the two number of the vertices. So more precisely, we have already seen in the Ferdinand-Koppenhausen bound this upper bound on the expectation of the trace. Okay, so combining the two, you obtain precisely the Bandera van Andel part. Okay, so now let us see how can it be useful. Okay, the Ferdinand-Koppenhausen bound asserts that if k, but the operator norm of s, okay, is of order 2 times square root r. Okay, and if you put if you take k to be as large as possible, so you upper bound the expectation of the norm by the expectation of the norm power k power 1 over k, and this is bounded by the trace, so you will get exactly this expression. So you have to play, you take k as large as possible, so what we have proven is that you can take r equal to r power 1 over 8, but if you could take k larger, you would get a better bound. So you get that the expectation of the norm of the s to the r is less than 2 square root r plus r power alpha, where alpha is some parameter which is between 3, 8. You can take anything close to 3, 8. Okay. You could improve on this alpha and taking alpha in fact equal to zero, but it's not necessary here. Okay. Another ingredients are this concentration inequality. Okay. So you can use the fact that you have a bound. The expectation of the norm of S to the of the operator norm of S, I should have written, sorry, the Talleyrand concentration inequality will tell you that the fact that if you look at the case moment of the operator norm of S, power 1 over k, it's less, so it's larger than the expectation of the norm of S, of the operator norm of S, but it is less but the expectation of the norm of S plus some universal constant times square root k. Okay? The constant depends on the fact that I've taken 1 over 4, but whatever. Okay, so the Talleyrand concentration inequality, which is an exponential deviation inequality of the operator norm from its expectation, you can turn it into a deviation inequality, an upper bounds for the all moments you want of in terms an upper bound on all moments you want of your random variable. Okay, and you will get a bound which is like expectation of your variable plus c times square root k. Okay, so so you obtain the following upper bound on the expectation of the trace of S power k by using that the trace is at most R times the operator norm. Okay. Okay, so now we are almost there. I recall you that you take R, K is even with our choice of R, which will be, so you can take K, any K. You take R, which is Q squared plus K. And you have the expectation, for example, of the largest eigenvalue of the matrix H, which is bounded by the normalized trace. So you use the Bordenave and Handel argument to say that the power of the expected trace of the matrix H, you can bound it in terms of the expected trace of the matrix S. Okay, and you have a completely explicit bound. Okay, so you can put together the first three inequalities. Okay, and optimize over K. Okay, so you optimize over K. I will spare you the details, but it's nothing fancy. Everything is completely explicit. And you will find that the expectation of the largest eigenvalue of H is at least 2 plus something which, where you will see the term square root of log n over Q appear. Okay. And the parameter delta will depend on the parameter alpha on the first line. I didn't write it explicitly because the parameter alpha was not optimal. And even in any case, this comparison argument will not give you an optimal bound. So so it's probably not worth it to write the explicit dependence on delta. Okay, but this is still very good because if Q is much larger than square root log n, the error term that you get goes to zero. Okay, so you obtain this result that if you have Wigner matrices with variance 1 and sparsity parameter 1 over Q, if Q is much larger than log n, then the almost sure limit of the largest eigenvalue is 2. Okay, so this first result was proved with, I proved this first result before, not using this comparison argument with Florent-Benaïs-George and Antinous. But we'll see the way we proved it later on. But so you see this Bordenave and Handel argument is quite shocking because you obtain an optimal, you obtain a bound which improves on the Furidian Komlosh bound. But this bound only use the Furidian Komlosh bound and a comparison argument plus some basic concentration inequalities. So almost at cost zero, by a smart argument, you are able to improve the reach of application of this Furidian Komlosh upper bounds. Okay, some remarks. So the same argument works for, as always, for inhomogeneous Wigner matrices with bounded row variance. Okay, and as I said, the bound Q larger than square root of log n is optimal. Okay, because we have seen that for Erdős-Schwenyi graph, you cannot expect to be to have something better, because Q larger than square root of log n corresponds to average degree larger than log n. Okay, so you will find this bounds in the references. So the original argument of Bordenave and Van Handel was not exactly the one I presented it, but there is the version which I've presented it is, you can find it in this paper by Latawa, Van Handel and Youssef. Okay, so now in the time which remains, I will move. If you have a question on this part, because okay, so I will move to another. Now we will see, let's see. I have to find my other slide for the time which remains. Let's see, it's here. An no, sorry. Let's see. I should. This one, probably. No. Ah, I took the wrong one, sorry. Can you see my slides now? Yes?
Yes, yes.
Okay, okay. Okay, so for the time, for the, I will just start. I will recall you, I will recall these slides tomorrow. So now we will see a way to improve this moment methods. And the way we will improve it is not by studying the matrix we are interested in directly, but by studying another matrix, which we call the non-backtracking matrix for a reason that will be clear. Okay, and as we will see, the fact that this idea of changing the matrix that we study by another one, which would correspond in some sense to changing, instead of looking at monomials, looking at other polynomials, will allow us to extend a lot the reach of application of this I-trace method, the ideas of Fioretti and Komlosh. Okay, so the non-backtracking matrix, what it is? So you take a matrix H of size n, okay, and you form a matrix B of size n squared. Okay, so you can think of that as a matrix whose entries are pairs of indices. Okay, and an order pair of vertex, it's convenient to think it as an oriented edge. Okay, so the entry EF, the entry EF of the matrix B, okay, so E is of is XY and F is AB, as this explicit form. Okay, so you take the value of H at the arrival vertex, so F is AB, so you take HAB, and then you put a, and it will be zero unless the arrival point of E is the starting point of F, so this is Y equal to A, okay? And the non-backtracking part is the fact that you require that the endpoint of F is not the start point of E, okay? So that's what I put on the picture. So this the important part is this X different from B, okay? So meaning that you put, if you, so it's a matrix in index on the oriented edges of your, in the kind of oriented indices of the matrix, of your matrix you started with. And this matrix, you built it so that it forces, you put zero every time that you see an edge and its reverse edge. Well, the reverse of an edge is if the reverse of XY is YX, okay? Okay, so I will put more details on this matrix, obviously, but so the first comment is that this matrix H is not Hermitian. Even if H is Hermitian, this matrix B is not Hermitian, okay? So for example, imagine that on the picture, you see that the entry EF is equal to one. Let's say that HIB is, or just the HIB is not negative. So the entry EF is not negative. Is not zero, sorry, but the entry FE will be zero, typically. Okay, so the matrix is not normal. Is not Hermitian. Normal meaning that a normal matrix is a matrix which has an orthonormal basis of eigenvector. Equivalent, it's a matrix which commutes with its adjoint. Okay, so so it seems to be a very bad idea to introduce this matrix because non-Hermitian matrices are quite difficult to study compared to Hermitian matrices. But still, we will see that the improvement that we get with this non-backtracking condition is much better than what you lose by losing Hermitianity. Okay, so a variant of this matrix. Typically, H could be a matrix whose non-zero entries are edges of an undirected graph. Okay. For example, H is an adjacency matrix of a graph. So you have a graph G with vertices are the first n vertices, the first n integers, and the edges are sets of an order pair of these integers. Okay. Then you could define the oriented edges of G, okay, as being the set of ordered pairs of edges. Okay, so instead of looking at sets x, y, you look at the pair, ordered pair x, y. In particular, the cardinal of E with the arrow is twice the cardinal of E. Okay? So now you could, instead of defining B on n squared, as I did, as a matrix acting on, as a matrix in MN in, of size n squared by n squared, you can see it as a matrix acting on oriented edges by the same formula, okay? And the two definitions will coincide because, so I will go from one definition to the other, because if you take F to be the linear space, the vector space spanned by so if you take the linear space of Rn squared spanned by coordinate vectors xy, where xy is not goes over all vertices, all the pairs which are not edges of the graph, then B and B star are invariant by F, and B are zero on F, and B stars also. And it's and by definition, B restricted to the orthogonal of F is exactly B tilde. Okay. So up to adding eigenvalues trivial up to adding zeros in the spectrum, it's depending on the application. You can either think about B as a matrix of size n squared, or when there is a natural graph associated to your matrix, it's usually more convenient to define B as B tilde, which acts on the oriented edges. Okay. And so why is it interesting to introduce these non-backlogging matrices? There are many answers to this question. One could be contained in this picture. If you take a power of the non-backlogging matrix B, okay, and you look at its entry EF, so you will get a sum over paths of products of the weights encountered in that pass, okay? But the sum, if you interpret them combinatorially, are non-backtracking paths from E to F of length k plus 1. Where non-backtracking means that gamma t minus 1 is different from gamma t plus 1. Okay, so it's a sequence gamma t, and you are not allowed to directly backtrack from where you came from, okay? And it starts at E, so you assume that gamma zero, gamma one is E, and the endpoint gamma k plus one is F. Okay, so on the picture, I look, E is my, for example, my arrow, my blue arrow on the bottom, F is my blue arrow on the top, and you can see a non-backtracking path you can see a non-backtracking path. So it is not allowed to directly backtrack. It can make cycles, but it cannot do it directly. Okay, so such path is a discrete geodesic. So locally, if you look at subpaths of length 2, it's the shortest path. Okay, and more generally, so this is a proper analog of geodesic in Riemannian geometry. Okay. Oh. At least one proper analog of geodesic in geometry. And on a tree, since there are no cycles, non-backtracking paths are just shortest paths. Okay, so the non-backtracking paths, their powers, since we will be interested by estimated powers, count non-backtracking paths, and non-backtracking paths, they have a very strong geometric flavor. Okay, they are much nicer than just closed paths. This restriction of being non-backtracking is very nice because on trees, it reduces yourself to looking at shortest paths, and more on any graph or any, you can interpret them as geodesic paths. Okay. And as we will see next time, we can use a lot these geometric properties of the non-matriking path to push forward as combinatorial estimates that we have proven so far. Okay, so probably I should stop here for this time. It's a good time to start. Okay, thank you. If you have questions.
Any questions? I have one question actually in this
layer
handle argument that you were giving. What is the importance of the Bernoulli? Was it only the lower bound on moments that you had? You compared it to a specific.
So here it was used just to find any, if you can take any distribution which has all moments of larger than two, non-negative, larger than one, sorry. Okay. If you find any other distribution, and you can find many others, it will work as well. Okay, the original Bandeira-Vanandel argument was for symmetric variables, so for variables distributed, and they were comparing directly to Gaussian entries. Because you're using Vick's formula and stuff like that. So here, for this version, which is a kind of asymmetric version of the original Bandeira and Vanandel argument, you can take any distribution which has when you have a good lower bound on for all moments.
Actually, a related question. I mean, you mentioned the Gaussian. In the Gaussian case, there is a more conceptual proof for the Fugedi-Komlos. This using the tridiagonal, it's a simpler argument without moment computations. Is there any way to do it for other variables from the Gaussian, or do you need the moment?
Okay, so if your moments are if your moments are dominated by the moments of a Gaussian. For example, if you have a sub-Gaussian random a symmetric sub-Gaussian random variable, I think that you could use the Bandeira-Vanandel argument to you could use the result on the G-libre. On the GUI or GOE matrix to use it for any other matrix with symmetric sub-Gaussian entries, I think. Because you see, we were not used for, in the arguments I presented, we use the Fugedi-Komlos bound just to have an estimate on the norm of the matrix S. But if by any other mean you have an estimate on the norm of the matrix S, you can use the comparison argument to deduce a bound on the norm of the matrix H. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you, Shah.
Thank you. I'll see you tomorrow.